Let me make some comments and then we could probably throw it open as a discussion if that works better for you. Pratima, the short answer to your question, will the current state of corruption and governance affect India Inc.? The short answer is yes, but in the short term. But in the long term, no. And I'll share why I say so. Let me put certain caveats on the floor. I am not an economist. I'm a pure and simple person who runs business. By qualification, I'm a dumb accountant. I'm not a bright MBA from some of the schools you kids have gone to. But I'm an optimist. But I'm a rare combination of an optimist and a dumb accountant. You know, so one takes you up and one brings you down. So, you know, so that's a good combination. And so I believe I'm balanced. But I think and when I say that not in the long term, I think you have to look at the history of India. In the last 15 years, and I was just making some points in this thing. In the last 15 years, from being nowhere, you know, before the BRICS report came out, nobody knew where India was. If you ask somebody walking on the street of Boston, they'll say, yeah, there's a country called India. We became the fourth largest economy in the world in PPP terms. And not many economies have traveled in about a decade that sort of a distance. You know, one of our biggest advantages, and when I was growing up, it was supposed to be the biggest negative, was our population. But today, the biggest advantage is, if you look at any demographic indexes, or indices as you would call it in America, every other country is aging. And I'm quite happy to share some of the statistics with you. India is the only country which has more than 50% of its population below the age of 25. And I'll tell you why I'm so optimistic about that. The world is consuming more, world is demanding more services. Forget my generation, even if you look at yourself, when you were in school, between your primary school and secondary school and college, and you just see how many things that you consume today, and more particularly what I call discretionary spend, is gone up so much that the world's going to demand more services. And as countries in Europe, for example, which will have a larger proportion of retirees who are being supported, they will need goods and services, and where those goods and services are going to come from. And here I would like to touch upon China for a little while. You know, Chinese have certain advantages, but I think in certain areas we are much stronger. For example, China also has a declining working population because of a single child policy that they introduced sometimes in the 50s or 60s. When you want to assemble Nokia telephones, or you want to assemble Sony televisions, or make Adidas shoes, or even if somebody, Walmart, wants to buy 1 million pajama suits for the kids, China is definitely ahead of us. And because the Chinese worker will sit there for 10 hours, ding, 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 ding. Because the Indian mind works like that. But when you want high precision stuff, even let's take the example of the clothing industry. If Walmart wants 1 million pajama suits for kids, it's China. But if a designer wants a hand stitched, embroidered, or some sort of, I'm not a very good in women's garments, but something like that, then people will go to India, because that sort of workmanship comes better from India. You look at IT industry, you know, where a technology is developed by a Cisco or a Intel or Dell or Steve Jobs, it goes to America for assembly. But when people want somebody to write software, they come to India. You know, that is the differentiation between India and China, besides the age divide, you know, that we are going to. So I think that's what is going to drive us forward. You know, as late as in the early 90s, service industry was one third of our economy. And the service industry is the fastest growing industry anywhere in the world. We are today 58%. I mean, that's the stride we have made. And that's what gives us, because in the 90s, agriculture was the dominant portion of our economy, and we have now moved to 58% services, 30-odd% manufacturing, and less than 20% of agriculture. We are somewhat insulated from the world economy in a positive sense. In the 2008 crisis, India is the only country which had one quarter of slowdown, only one quarter, which was December 8. Even in, and because we go by fiscal year, which is April to March, even in 2008-2009, we had, I think, 6.7% GDP growth. Last year we had a 10% GDP growth, 9.8 or something like that. Any guess what the Indian savings rates are? America has, after 25 years, had for the first time a positive saving rate. Otherwise, you are more spending than earning. Can you take a guess what's India's savings rate? Any guess around the table? 35%. It's actually 35.7. Domestic saving rate is excess of 24%. You know, there are lots of positives. Most Indian companies, while everybody is grumbling around the world, even last year had a 20% growth in top line. That's the average of the Indian industry. Our company grew more than 35% in top line. The bottom line hasn't grown in that proportion the last 3 years, primarily because of commodity prices. So I'm saying that in that context, you have to look at India. Why do I say in the short term we are going to suffer? Because I think we have three problems. We have problems, and I'll come to the problem. But my optimism comes from two or three factors. One, Pratima mentioned, is there is now at the grassroots level, a man on the street level, as you would call it, there is some amount of resistance building up as to why we are accepting this sort of a thing. You know, in the earlier days, see, one of the things which makes me positive in this situation, because, you know, Hinduism, religion which is the prominent religion, predominant religion, what about 80-odd% of people are Hindus, teaches you that this is your karma, this is your fate. So people don't normally protest. You know, people accept it as fate, people accept it as destiny. And although we were a very poor country, and we still continue to be a poor country, you will find that an average Indian has a smile on his face much more than an average European or an American. No.
It's true.
So it just shows what your mindset is. So we accept a lot of things as karma. And in that society, if millions of people took to streets for somebody who was not heard of, Anna Hazare was nobody. I may not agree the way Anna Hazare did his thing. I have a philosophical difference with him, because I don't think you can blackmail governments to get certain things done. That's a different issue. But the larger issue is that people are now standing up and saying enough is enough. Top Indian businessmen have written in the last 6 months two open letters to the Prime Minister. I mean, they gave copies to the press along with writing, saying, sorry, we need better governance. And these include people like my boss, her grandfather, Mr. Mahendra, Dr. Ganguly, who used to be chairman of Unilever and is actually a member of parliament by invitation, because we have four seats in the parliament which are by invitation. They're nominated. Chairman of ICICI Bank. So, you know, people at that level have written. If you go back and if you read Indian newspapers, day before yesterday, Azim Premji, which is the chairman of the second largest software company in the country, said India is going to suffer because of no decisions being taken in the government. You know, because what happens is that when you have things like that, people are fighting fires, so there's nothing happening. This is like no press here, like President Obama is only fighting fires, you know. So when does he develop his economic policies? You know, but where does the optimism and the pessimism come? You know, I said in short term it's going to affect and in the long term it's not going to affect. I like to put the problems in three baskets. And I'll take your favorite basket of corruption last, because on that, because if I start on that, then you'll be here till dinner time. So let me take the first basket. The first basket I would put financial and economic situation that we are seeing in the country, and number one on the list being inflation. We are a hyperinflation country. We even last month had 9.7%. When I say last month, I mean September, because I've been traveling from 1st of November, so I haven't seen the October indices. In September, we had 9.7% inflation. But what is really, really hurting is the food inflation is very high, which is hurting the poor people. You know, in India, there was a saying, my Indian friends will understand, that he's a poor man, at least he gets to eat dal and rice. But now rice, dal is pulses. Even the pulses prices have gone beyond the reach of a common man. And I think that's hurting, but I will touch on inflation a little later. I'll come back to inflation. The other is something which I am personally very concerned about, and it's something that I would like to do in part of my second innings of life, is the gap between rich and poor is widening very fast. Although our middle class has risen in the last few years, now we have close to 127 million households, which we call middle class, we still have one third of the population which is relatively poor. To give you a couple of examples, kids of your age come out of a five-star hotel and talk in the car that we bought a bottle of wine, you know, that wine was so damn expensive, and in rupees we paid 10,000 rupees, which is about $200 for a bottle of wine, and you know, we paid 40,000 rupees for dinner, and his driver, because he has a driver at that time, because you can't drink and drive, his driver makes 10,000 rupees a month, in which he supports not only his children, but he's probably got his old parents to support. You know, so you are spending four times a man's salary on a meal which you didn't need. You know, now that sort of a thing is, I think, totally unfair in a balanced society. Ramani, you will relate to that. I give an example when I talk that 20 years ago, if my mother, you know, in India we believe that on some auspicious day you should go and feed the poor. If my mother said that we had to feed to the poor, we would have to go to a temple to look around people who were hanging around the temple. Then we started seeing these people at street corners, but they would sit there. Then they started coming to your car. Today they knock at your car if you're on the telephone and demand money. You know, so this is one sign of people. And I think this is something which is not going to hurt the affect the global economy or the people who do business with India, but people who live in India have to be conscious of it, that we have to learn as a nation to give. You know, we've been a hoarding nation. You know, people want to hoard money. I think if you have money, you have to give it. Philanthropy has to be part of your life. Interest rates. The Fed governor, we call it the RBI, has in the last 18 months increased the repo rate by 13 times. We have moved up from 4.75% to 8.75%. If your repo rate is 8.75%, no bank can lend you at less than 11 or 12%. Now that's hurting both the consumer, because people who take mortgage loans or people who take loans for whatever. And it is also hurting investment, because companies are finding it, because if your borrowing rates are 11 or 12%, then your IRRs have to be at least 2 or 3% higher than that, otherwise why are you getting into risk capital? The IIP numbers have been declining. IIP is what we call the index of industrial production. It was as high as 14% early last year, 2010, February, March, it used to be 14%. It is down to 4%. But that has got other connotations. The reason for that is that you've probably been reading in the papers that suddenly our environment minister has overnight become, has gone from this extreme to that extreme. So nobody is getting environment clearances to put up the projects. Interest rates I mentioned about. The feel-good factor is, you know, businessmen, India Inc. makes, anywhere in the world, people make investment when the feel-good factor is good. And the other problem is that because of environmental reasons, the power projects are not getting their fuel linkages. You know, you can't go and invest in a power plant till your coal supply or the gas supply is linked to it. Fiscal deficit last year was 5.1%. We had budgeted 4.6% this year, but I think we'll end up slightly higher because of the commodity prices going up, especially the oil and other reasons. And the rupee has depreciated, so our oil costs, rupee actually depreciated by nearly 11% in August and September. Why am I still optimist? I think let's take one by one. I think the government has, my personal opinion, government is not taken the right steps for inflation, this thing. They're just trying to use monetary tools, which is interest rates and that sort of, and making less credit available to reduce. But I think we are not addressing the supply side, because if your supply side is not, see, because we also have a parallel economy. So there are people who are extremely rich who are not concerned. So if you don't increase the supply side and you're only trying to control the demand side, then you're going to have probably more problems on that sort of a thing, and we need to address that. And Brazil is an example which, in an inflationary situation, I don't know how many of you know, they actually reduced the interest rates because they wanted to encourage more investment into the system and bring down the inflation rate. We have lived with interest rates. Even in 2006, 2007, we had that sort of a thing. Interest rates move, so people get used to it. It's a question of policy. It's move. We'll not go down to 2-3%, but we will come down to 6-7%. I think if we can sort out some of the policy issues on the environmental front, and the next round I'm going to talk about the energy sector, which is going to be the largest investor. I think that area can be noted. Our exports have gone up by 37% this year. So the fiscal and the trade deficit will, over a period of time, come down. And I personally believe that some of these commodity prices are at unreal numbers, and they're not driven by business reasons or economic reasons. They're driven by speculative reasons, you know, because there's no reason for oil to have jumped to 150 and then comes down to 40 and then goes up to 112. I think there's a lot of, and if you follow the oil futures, the futures are four times what the actual world global consumption is. So there's obviously a lot more speculative activity happening there, and it cannot go on forever. I think once the rupee depreciated because people got slightly worried globally on what's going to happen in euro, and this drew the money. But I think India is still one of the hotter destinations for investment. So at some stage, the rupee will, money will start flowing in, and then you will see the rupee not strengthening too very, but this correction will probably happen. So although I highlighted all these negative factors, these are all, according to me, reasonably addressable factors. I mean, there's nothing that one needs to lose sleep on. It just needs, and I'll come down to the last time when I come at the governance part, I think it needs somebody there sitting and looking at those issues, and that's the thing. I think the second bucket is what I call policy reforms and infrastructure development. Now, I started off by saying what happened in the last 15 years. And because 15 years ago, when the current Prime Minister was the Finance Minister, Narasimha Rao, that's the first time we had some radical policy reforms. Probably that's the only time we really had some policy. Our import duty in 95 for some of the items was 355%. So if you wanted to import a car, you will pay 3.5 times the price of the car as import duty. And the import duties have come down to the highest rate of duty is now 15%, average is sub 10%. You know, so that's the radical reform that we've had. I remember when I used to travel as a youngster, you could afford one meal and the rest of the time you went to a KFC or a McDonald's, because we used to get limited exchange when we traveled. You used to get some less than $100 a night. So you would look for the cheapest hotel and you will try to see that you can fly overnight, so you saved the thing. From that point, and it was not that people couldn't afford it, it was foreign exchange restriction, because when you traveled, you could not buy more than, because I think an average was allowed, what, 2,500, earlier it was 500, then it became $500, then it became $2,500 in a year. So in that sort of money, I mean, you didn't think of going to a fancy restaurant. So the McDonald's was a big deal for us, you know. So otherwise, you'd buy some bread from a grocery store and put some slice of ham in it. Because it's not that we couldn't afford it, but we didn't have the currency. And from that, we became, rupee became totally convertible. So now you have Ramani Narulas going into Saks Fifth Avenue and buying.
I'm not sure she does it. But no, we have foreign exchange reserves of $300 billion.
There was a time that's when we had our reserves had come down to $8 billion, which was 10 days of oil import. And today we have foreign exchange reserves of. So I'm saying that we have. But what happened? After that, we froze. And we are still in the state of, we need to defreeze ourselves. World goes where people feel comfortable. And today, unfortunately, thanks to the media, or because of the media, I think people have a little concern about India, and I think we need to get a better investment climate, make people feel more friendly. And I must share with you something a friend of mine once told me. He was chairman at that time of Mitsubishi Corporation, which you know is one of the world's largest corporations. And he told me in his typical Japanese style, "Nana-san, India very difficult to get in, but very easy to make money. China very easy to get in, but very difficult to make money." You know, it's a fact that, you know, once you come in, there's the business climate is such you can make money. But coming in, and I think we need to get that sorted out. You know, I don't want to get into too many details. For example, we now need to move to goods and services tax, which paper has already been there, the legislation there, but we have some states which belong to the opposition who are not agreeing to it, and you cannot have a goods and service tax across the country unless everybody signs off. You can't have it in pockets. And the good news about goods and services taxes that it will increase the tax net, because today agricultural income is not taxed in India. The people who live on agricultural income or agricultural produce, there are no taxes. Forget for income tax, they don't even pay other taxes. So once you bring GST, you'll probably get a larger people within the tax net. The other area of reform that we need is agricultural productivity. You know, we come from historical background that there were small rulers, and then there were fiefdoms, and there were little states. So the farm holding was in the hand of the nobility. So when India got its independence, we brought in what we call a Land Regulation Act. So they said that the maximum size of land an individual can hold is 50 acres. Now that was all right in the 40s, 47, 48, when we enacted that law. But from 48, now it's the third generation. So if somebody had 50 acres of land and he had three sons, and then his three sons had three sons each. So everybody has got less than, so, there are nine children, so they have less than 5 acres of land. In fact, somewhere the, because people used to have 10 children, so sometimes the farm holdings are less than 1 acre, so they cannot mechanize it. They can't invest in pumps. So the farm productivity is very low. We are actually, farm productivity is less than 1/3 of China. So I think we need to have some reforms there on, say for example, corporate farming or cooperative farming, so that, you know, people can, because there are today corporates do it. It's happening in Eastern Europe that corporates go and take farms on contract. They manage the farm and they share the produce with the landowner. So I think we need to have an agricultural reforms in that area. A lot of work is being done, including our company. There is a company called ITC who have brought in a lot of IT into the farm. So the farmer knows what is happening, what's the prices in the market, what's the weather patterns, what are the new cropping options, what are the seeds that are available. So there is something happening, but I think we need more radical change into that. But I think the most important, according to me, is that we need social sector reforms, because we need to upgrade. See, the education system, while when you come to a business school or a medical school or an engineering school, I think we are comparable to the best in the world. And some of you probably heard of our IITs and IIMs, and they produce some, I mean, your dean is a product of that. So there is that, but secondary education, we are still following what the British left us with. So the education has no linkage with employment. So the education is what the British left us, and probably the education system or the course curriculum were developed in somewhere in the 20s. So, you know, it's 90 years old and the world has moved. And I think we need huge reform in that area. The second is that education teachers in the government and the average, leave the international schools, are still the lowest paid, and so you're not getting the best talent there. So I think we need a huge reform. And it hurts me that even 60 years post-independence, we have cases of malnutrition, we have cases of waterborne diseases, we have cases, because while you have people who do, you know, we are a very popular destination for health tourism. So people come from England for their knee replacements and open heart surgeries, but when you come down to a rural health center, people don't get enough treatment for even things like a cholera or a diarrhea. And I think we need to do some amount of work, not some, reasonable amount of work in that to do that. And I think we need second round of major economic reforms. I think two sectors have been left out. One is retail, which is a very political this thing. And I personally feel retail will do a lot of good to the community. And when I come to inflation, I'll touch on retail again. And the second is financial sector reform. We still have restrictions on foreign banks foreigners investing in our banking system or the insurance system, which again is a legacy of the past, in the sense that 70-odd% of the banking sector, right, Ramani, would be nationalized banks, public sector banks, or maybe it's about 70%. So if 70% is public sector banks and they open it up, then they're worried that there may be unions in this side may vote against them, so that's a concern that they have. And similarly with insurance is 90% is insurance is controlled by public sector. It's only 10% which is controlled. So, you know, so I think we need to bring those reforms. And if you look at, it's not only the foreign banks, the Indian private banks, ICICI and HDFC, have outperformed. In fact, HDFC today, I don't remember the exact number, but I think banking stocks in NYSE are less than 2 times book, and HDFC is 14 times book, and their investors are mostly funds from United States, the capitals of this world. So, you know, so I mean, there's obviously something they're doing right. The other item in this basket is infrastructure. And you would be pleasantly surprised when the world is dying for opportunities to do something. India needs $1 trillion of investment in the next 5 years on infrastructure. $1 trillion. And all this money, you know, in real term, it's a $1.3 trillion economy. In PPP terms, we are a $4.5 trillion economy. In real terms, it'll be a $1.3 trillion economy. So we can't generate $1 trillion of investment in 5 years from our own savings. There is an opportunity for foreign investment there. And to just give you some example, roads, we need to add 55,000 kilometers of road in the next 5 years, which will attract $100 billion. We need to get 70,000 megawatts of power, both conventional as well as what we call the
alternate, the green fuel
or the clean tech, which will attract $150 billion of investment. Telecom. Can anybody guess what's the number of telecom connections we add every month? Not my Indian friend.
No.
Can anybody take a guess? We add 8 to 10 million telephone connections every year. 8 to 10 million handies are sold.
So
new connections, not the instruments.
So Arun, what is our gross number now? 700 million? 670.
670 is the last count. What do we need to do? I think we have to sort out land issues, because when I come to corruption, I'll talk. Land became politically the most sensitive issues, and you know, so, and we Indians always jump, you know, either we have no discipline on what we are eating or we starve. Similarly, on you say we are going on fast.
Feast of famine, as we call it.
No. So there, you know, the Muslims go on fast for 30 days. They'll not eat between sunrise and sunset. And if you go at midnight to one of these street markets, you'll feel people are gobbling food which you would be seen dead to eat if you were from Harvard. Because it's all deep fried, soaked in the sugar syrup and with lot of fat into it, and they're eating biryanis and they're eating jalebis, and you know. So whole day we fasted and then we missed. So similarly on land related, at one time we were doing land grabs, and now we say you cannot, nobody can buy agricultural land. You know, so I think we need to sort it out, that part of the problem. I think we need to have an environmental issue. We are all conscious of the fact that we, in fact, I put it very simply by saying the world that we have, the ecology, the environment, is something which we have not inherited from our grandparents. It's something which we have borrowed from our grandchildren. So we have to leave it behind for them. So we are conscious of the fact. But I think we need to have policies which will take care. You cannot shut down everything, because 250 million jobs have to be created over the next 7 years. So if you don't have industrial production, how are you going to create jobs for those people? I think we have to weed out corruption, and I have not forgotten that subject, and I will come down to it. I think we need to create a level playing field for international investors as well as people who have connections with the government. And I think we need to be faster in our decision-making process. Having said that, let me come to my friend's favorite subject, corruption. You know, corruption has happened. What happened? Why? Because I'm not going to talk, look at, because now there are no statistics. Since some of you are taking notes, I wanted to be precise on the numbers. So that's why I was looking at the numbers, because statistics, corruption is not something new. Again, it is something which we inherited from the British. And if you go back, there's a term called bakshish. The bakshish word never existed in the, if you go into the old Hindu scripts or Indian scripts, you will not find the word bakshish. Bakshish is something which was created by the British. It's a relatively new word in the Indian language. Bakshish was that I did you something and you gave me bakshish for that. And so it was, you know, the British officer will do something for you, and in terms of bakshish, you would carry.
Bakshish is a gift, no?
Yeah. Yeah. You carry. Gift normally you say when you have a birthday or a wedding. So bakshish is you can give it for anything. You know? How did the British get India? Means if you go through the history, they bribed somebody's prime minister, they bribed somebody's army chief, they bribed somebody's brother. So it's not new. It's just that the media is playing it up today. But there is a damn good news there, because I always look for good news. Do you know, at least I don't know of any other country, and I know that all the G7 countries do not have it, is we have something called Right to Information Act. Now you have, I think, 20 years of this thing, the papers come out after 20 years, I think it's 12 years or 20 years?
Freedom of Information Act.
Sorry?
The Freedom of Information Act?
Yeah.
Yeah, you can apply and get...
After 20 years?
No,
you can apply immediately.
Immediately.
No.
Talking about governmental secrecy laws for 75 years in the US.
But here you can have access to any government paper by under the Right to Information Act, and the media has opened. So actually, in one way, it is good that people are coming to know, because Right to Information Act and the media is now, you're reading more about it. I don't think things have changed. The only thing which has changed, which has led to the current level of corruption, is what I call coalition politics.
Yeah.
You know, when there is a single party in power, then they have a mandate, they don't worry about it. But when you have coalition and you know that you are there for a short period of time, and I always give the example, if you know your next meal is assured, and I don't think Americans will relate to it, but you go to Africa and you'll know that when a guy knows that he's going to get his next meal and he's going to get his, he will only eat what is required, or he may even eat little less. But when you don't know when your next meal is going to come, then you stuff yourself. And that's what happens to politicians. He doesn't know in a coalition politics that he's going to be there, how long he's going to be there. So he says, let me collect what I can. But going, if I want to take the subject sensibly, there are three types of corruption which happen. One is a very petty corruption, but the most irritating one, which is that something which is due to you, you paid more taxes than you are required to pay, because we have a concept of tax reduction at source, you know, when you... from your salary it's deducted, from your interest it is deducted, and you want your tax refund, the guy says, you pay me something, I'll give you. Now that's a matter of right, you're not asking. You want your driving license renewed, the guy wants. I'll give you personal experience that I got extremely irritated. I had to give a flat on rent, lease out a rent, and if you want yourself to be protected from the tenant not vacating over after a certain period, then you go and register the document with the, there's a land record office, you go and register it, so that then you can go through what we call it's a quick disposal of this thing, that you go there and you say that this was my lease, it's expired, he's not vacating, and the court will immediately order that. And to show that this was a registered document in this, you go and register. So the guy sitting there has got nothing to do except that on his computer, I electronically sign and he takes my picture and the other picture and records. He has nothing to do. He has no application of mine. But unless you pay him 250 rupees or 500 rupees, he will find some technical fault or make you wait, because there's no token system. So the broker who... And the problem is, probably the brokers have spoiled him. The guy is not there, because the broker wants to please his client and he slips in a little few hundred rupee notes to him and gets you out of turn. Now that sort of corruption is a very irritating corruption. But there, I must say that I work on these issues very, I'm very passionate about it. And we are convincing the government that why can't we do it electronically? Why do I have to go and show my damn face to that joker? Why can't I do it on the internet? That both of us do it, and then there is no need. You want your 250 rupees, we'll pay it through the credit card. If I have had no accident or any police complaint or I have not violated, I should be able to renew my driving license through electronically. Why do I have to go and give a few hundred rupees to somebody? Now, that corruption, there are three things that we have suggested to the government. One, we have suggested that normally the guy who gives bribe is equally responsible. For these type of things, the guy who gives bribe should not be found guilty, so that he will then share the information. Otherwise, if Shloka has given 500 rupees to get her driving license renewed out of turn or quickly, or she didn't want to stand in the queue, she will not complain. But if somebody has harassed her and said that if you don't pay me 500 rupees, I'll make you come three times, if she is going to be also guilty, then she is not going to complain. So we are saying that these petty crimes, the giver should not be punished. Second, move as much as possible on the electronic e-governance, so that sort of a thing doesn't happen. And three is, something which was an offshoot of these, but these are the two things that I'll think about it and come back. The second is what I call collusive corruption. You are a government officer, you have to give a contract for a road, and I fix it up with you. And now that is very difficult to find out because it's collusive, you know, we both. Now, how does it happen? Suppose I want a contract and you say the contract will only be, I'm exaggerating, will be given to somebody who's 80% bald, is 5 feet 4 inches or 5 inches tall, his waistline is 36 inches. I mean, that guy can only qualify. So you put out the terms depending on what you will qualify for rather than
what should be.
So you say that somebody who has built a bridge with 36 spans. No, why can't it be with 40 spans? So you create a situation where you open it up on a particular day and it's a holiday and nobody, you know, it's collusive, so you do that.
2G scam. Yes,
no, 2G is a much deeper scam. I'll come to that. That I call exploitive
politics.
Because that's a different. Here it is done, it's collusive, it is done for the purpose of getting benefit to people. You do something in a manner that you benefit somebody and both the parties benefit out of it. Now there, I think, you need much larger transparency. You need, and that's why I touched upon this regulatory environment, that you should have regulators who are totally independent, who can look at it. See, one of the things for which actually I got a nice box of chocolates from the French finance minister day before yesterday at Nice, because, you know, everybody was talking around the table that World Bank says that $1.1 trillion are lost of public fund because of corruption, 30% more is spent on this. And I said, no, the loss is much, much larger. Let me give you an example. At least in India, it surely happens. If he is the public works chief engineer and I am a contractor, if we collude and we do something, forget that 1 trillion is that 10 or 15% more than what is the value of the road that he is given. That goes into 1 trillion. But if he is in my pocket, the quality of road that I am going to build is going to be far inferior to than if he was an honest officer who was going to. So, a road which should have lasted 40 years or 30 years, after 3 years will start developing potholes. So it's not only the repair of the cost, the millions of cars that you, if you start, if I start giving you, adding on, you will find how much is the loss that is coming too. The fuel cost of the thing, the time cost of the people that are going through. You know, secondly, if she is the education officer and I am the dumbest student of the class and she appoints me a teacher because I have given her a personal favor, I am spoiling the life of the next 10, 20, 30 generations. You know, that cost is not added in the 1 trillion that the World Bank comes out with. There's a huge cost that leads to that. And that is why the state of the roads, the state of the water supply is that. So I think we need to, this one, people have to protest. If a road gets damaged after 3 years, people have to come up and say, why is it this road was, and it is happening in Bombay. If you go through it, the Citizens and the Times of India have taken it up and they've started, they've blacklisted all the contractors who had, there were apparently 15 contractors who were getting it in rotation. They were the same people, and out of the 15, there were actually 5, because the others were their dummy companies. And they had this sort of a thing going around. And there are 3 or 4 things that has to be done. One is transparency and regulation. B, I think we need to have the quick court decisions to punish those guys. You know, like it has happened in TG, because unless you publicly, you know, punish him, because people are, they don't want to lose face in front of their children. And the third is that we need to pay our officers well. You know, one of the problems is that there is a huge disparity between public service, public servants and the private sector. So the guy sees his neighbor is driving a big car and I'm not having it. And I think we need to pay people well. One of the reasons places like Singapore do not have corruption, although rest of the same, we are the same lot of people. There's corruption in Malaysia, there's a huge corruption in Indonesia, Singapore, Vietnam, China, but why not in Singapore? Because people are adequately paid, and so, you know, I go back to my old theory that if your stomach is full and you are assured of your second meal, then you don't want to eat something which you don't need. But if you don't know, I mean, in the old days when people, when they traveled through the desert, the camel used to store additional water to take care. I mean, it's human nature. So we need to pay people well. The third is the worst part of the criminal, is what I call a criminal corruption, which is pure exploitation. I am in power. I go and forcibly buy your land and then change the land use, because agricultural land has X. The moment it becomes residential, it will become 10X or 15X or 20X. And you go and put forts, you go and knock at people's holes, send mafias to their house, so create all sorts of problems, collect that land. Similarly, mining, similarly, telephone. But this again is, my friend, it is coalition. If you look at it, none of these are done by the parties, and these are all small. The biggest corruption was that Munda fellow, who was a chief minister for 15 days. Yeah. He made $200 million in 15 days. He just gave away some mining rights to people and collected money.
Koda also.
Huh?
Koda.
Badu Koda. Sorry. Badu Koda.
Actually, he's referring
he made $1 billion. He made 6,000 crores. That's the number.
Achha, I don't remember that. Madhu Koda. I was talking about Madhu Koda.
Madhu Koda. Jharkhand.
Because it's a very mineral rich, and he just gave away mining rights to people. And I personally feel these guys should be castrated. You know? On a more serious note, I believe, and I strongly believe, I think we need to rewrite our constitution, because what we wrote 65 years ago doesn't work today. You know, what has happened is that in this federal setup, there are too many regional parties who have come up. So I think the way we elect the federal government has to be probably re-looked at. It has to be something like your system, where the chief executive of the country is appointed separately and you have a parliament which controls him. Similarly, in the corporation, you appoint the mayor and then the citizens appoint the mayor, because the mayor in India is a dummy, because it's the government which controls the bureaucracy and they just have a power to that standing committee to look at. The operating decisions are left to bureaucrats who are in turn controlled by another set of politicians. I think we need to re-look at this sort of a situation. But where did my optimism come from? I think the younger generation is now realizing, you know, there was a time, I think one of the reasons that we've got into this situation is in my generation, we lived in larger families and you had aunts and grandmothers who told you stories and all stories had morals. Today, in Shloka's generation, whether getting admission to a good school is so competitive in class, then you want your daughter to know ballet, you want her to be good in debate, she must play the piano, she must know music, she must know dance. So there is no time for the values being given as a part of the system. And in one of the recommendations that I made at the Cannes summit was values have to, see the company that I work for, I'll be completing 40 years in that company in 2 years' time. And I have worked in that company for 1 year. They are, don't go and tell your granddad. They are not the highest paymasters. Because if I had gone to a, it's anywhere in the world, no, that Ford Motor Car Company doesn't pay you Goldman Sachs salary. So I'm not saying that, and I'm an accountant, I was very mobile. No, it's a fact, no, that I can go to any industry. I'm an accountant, I'm a CFA. CPA, what you call a chartered accountant. But the reason I worked for that company is I did not have to one day go to bed with my conscience telling me that I did something which I ought not to have done. Because I had that value system. But a lot of my friends changed jobs because they got a 20% raise. Now, you somewhere have to trade off the money to your conscience. And one of the things that I have been, it was a very strong part of my recommendation, and when I spoke, I said, I work for this company for my 38th year because ethics and governance is part of the DNA of the organization. Similarly, unless these things are made a part of the DNA of the system, you cannot have one preacher trying to do this. So I believe that it has to be started at school level. You have to teach. If you go around and look at your friends, you are younger, but talk to your seniors. More parents have given up smoking because their children told them to give up smoking rather than the doctor telling them it's injurious to your health. And I can give you many examples. In Delhi, these firecrackers were made by child labor. And we were working very hard to stop it. Till somebody once got the idea that we'll go and tell, show films to school students that how these kids work in these unhealthy conditions to make firecrackers which you enjoy. And the school kids banned firecrackers. And the whole industry has now got automated. Because, you know, making crackers is a very easy thing. So they were exploiting child labor in Shivakasi in South to make that. And for 10, 15 years, NGOs were fighting till somebody came and said, we will tell the kids not to burn crackers. So I'm taking that example that you have to go down to the level of school kids and start educating them, because then only the country will move. It will take a little longer time. But it is something which will be enduring. It will become part of the system. The second I touched upon, that I think we need to relook at our political system, because I think this coalition politics is this thing. Third, your castration may be a very extreme example, but people have to be publicly humiliated. You know, while legally I think the 2G, keeping people behind bars without a trial, is not fair, but I think it is now sending messages, whether it is the Commonwealth Games of Suresh Kalmadi or whether it is that people are realizing that, you know, I mean Suresh Kalmadi may have made millions, he may be a very successful businessman, but what face will he go and stand to his grandchildren that, you know, I'm in jail for because I made money? No, you know, I would rather not have money than my grandchildren looking away to say that, you know, my granddad is a crook. And I think we need to do those things. Having said that, I go back to my old theory that, you know, while I may not agree with Anna Hazare's method, because I personally don't think you can blackmail governments to do this, and I don't think Lokpal bill is the solution to this, but we need to do electoral reforms. Criminalization of politics. I'll give you a personal example. I had gone to meet the chief minister of one of the states. She had invited me for breakfast. And she said, why don't we have a tractor plant in, you have so many tractor plants in the country, why not in my state? And I said, ma'am, I'm scared of law and order situation. She said in Hindi, but I'll translate it. She said, you know, when we distribute tickets to for the assembly, you know, which is the state,
State elections.
Yeah, no, like you have the parliament, which is your senate. We have assemblies and we call them, like, what would you must be, what is the equivalent here?
State legislature.
So when we distribute tickets for this thing, some criminals come in. But you know, I have now told them that you're a member of legislature. You should stop doing what you were doing in the past. You know, what comfort does it give to a businessman